We met Josh a few years ago. He did a workshop at Daymary Music for musicians. And we heard him play before, too, so we were really excited to meet him. And just on the heart, and seriously, we're so excited to have him because it's been a number of years ago that we said, would you ever be willing to come and work with our teenagers? And he was so gracious then, and then, you know, to have many years later, do you remember the two weird ladies that talked to you? And he was just very kind and said he would love to come and work. Really excited to have him. And please make sure you tell your friends about the concert Thursday night, because you know that great big stadium seating in that radio center where we had teen camp last year? You can bring your friends because he really does an awesome show. And I think you're going to do some stuff with your wife next week, aren't you? Had you decided or not whether you're
going to? She's not going to.
Oh, okay. And with the baby, we weren't sure if that was going to work out, or they just had their first baby. So, Josh Wright, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome, Josh.
Questions to each of you guys. Why are you taking piano lessons?
Because their mothers are making them.
Yes. Moms are making you is like the most popular answer. Probably the boys in the back are nodding their heads. What are some other reasons you're taking piano lessons? Yeah.
You need to learn another musical instrument.
Okay. Sounds good. So it not only to learn music, but it can also help you in another instrument. Like I know a lot of my violin and cellist friends study piano to strengthen their technique, and it also provides a nice visual to help you with violin. Because violin, you're just playing this, you know, these random strings. It almost seems like, but piano, it's very visual. It's very nice to lay out that way. Yeah.
I watched my dad, and he was really good at playing the piano, and I wanted to be like him, so I started taking piano lessons.
Awesome. So good examples in your life of people who have already played. Great. Anyone else? Yeah.
To develop our talents.
Good. Very nice. It's so amazing in today's society to have something to share that's of value. Yeah. Did you have something? Somebody else? All right. Let's move on. What do you guys enjoy most about piano?
Cricket.
All the different styles you can play.
Great, all the different styles you can play. So you can play jazz, pop, classical, and within classical there's so many different styles, so many different time periods. And each composer poses its own set of challenges and set of rewards. Yeah.
To see our progress throughout the years.
Good, very nice. So it's so fun to track progress and to do camps like this where you can see other people progress. And that's why I continuously perform recitals. It continuously helps me become a better musician and a better performer. What do you guys hate most about the piano?
Practicing.
Having to perform in front of people, that's a big one. But everybody is saying practicing. Why do you guys not like practicing?
It takes forever.
It takes forever?
Okay. You don't just get to do what you want to do.
What would you rather be doing than practicing?
Playing what?
Playing what?
Playing whatever songs I want.
Oh, okay. So you like playing the piano, but you just don't like having to play the pieces that you're assigned. Okay. That's actually normal a lot of times. I mean, Chopin is my favorite, so playing something by Haydn is not as enjoyable for me as playing something by Chopin. But I still am willing to do those, practice those other pieces because it will help my Chopin play. Because I'll understand, the more you know about different styles, the more you will appreciate and know about the current style you're playing. So that's why it's important, if you hate scales but you love to play chords, you still do the scales because that's going to help you develop in different areas. Why else is practicing so horrible sometimes? Yeah?
The repetition and metronome.
Okay, so using the metronome is not always the most fun thing. And just having to do it over and over again. We're going to cover today efficient practice and how we can actually make our practice enjoyable and more efficient. If I could tell you, you could play that Chopin etude within a month, every single one of you would probably do what it took to be able to play that. But if you're like on Mary Had a Little Lamb and then you can play Row, Row, Row Your Boat, if you really work hard for a month, you'd be like, I'm not interested. It's not enough of an incentive to make me do the practicing. Okay, so we're going to go over ways to get faster at learning something, get faster at polishing something. There's three areas we're going to cover today. The first is how to become a better sight reader. The second is how to organize your practice sessions. And the third is how to polish a piece. And I'm going to show you guys how to polish a piece I'll play next week. I haven't practiced it yet. I mean, I perform it all the time, but I haven't played it for about a month now. And I'll show you how I bring some of those things back. But first of all, one of the most basic fundamental skills of the piano is being able to read at sight. How many of you just love sight reading? There's always a couple, okay? So maybe about 8 out of 30, just estimating. How many of you absolutely despise sight reading? And I bet those of you raising your hands are really bad at it, right?
Yeah.
Are you really bad at sight reading?
Yeah.
How many of you are so good at sight reading and you hate it? Anybody? Are you really good at it?
No.
And you hate it?
Yeah.
Why?
Because I don't like playing the piano.
Okay, well that's something altogether different. If you're just saying I don't like piano in general, but it's very rare for someone to hate something that they're really good at. It does happen, but I want to show you guys some ways to get better at sight reading. So. One of the most frustrating things is the disorienting habit of looking up and down at the music all the time. That's something that I see commonly with every student. I have this girl that I teach, just absolutely awful at sight reading 2 months ago. She could barely get through like simplified hymns. And today she's reading out of the normal hymn book with fluency. Like she'll do like 5 or 6 hymns a week. It's a very easy concept. So let's have, just in the front row here, 3 kids stand up about evenly spaced here. This might be a super stupid demonstration, but we're going to try it anyway. So let's have you 3 stand right here. Okay. Now, yep, space out about just a couple feet. Perfect. Just stand, step forward just a little bit. Perfect. Okay, now I'm going to have you 2 demonstrate with me, okay? So this is going to be, you stand up. Okay, now. Go right here. Okay, now I need you to look behind you the whole time, and only every 10 seconds can you look forward. Then you have to look back. Okay, and I need you to navigate your way through those kids. So you're going to do a snake through that. Okay?
Okay?
You have to look behind you the whole time. Okay, walk through them. Okay, you can look forward once. Okay, now back. Okay, now go back through.
Dang.
He's doing really good. Okay, you can look forward. Okay. Now you come up. Now go much faster. Go as fast as you can. You can look forward the whole time. Okay? Okay? He did really good. I was surprised at how good he did. But she was able to just do it immediately. Okay? You guys can sit back down. Thanks for your demonstration. It's kind of a silly little demonstration. But what it's showing you is that if you're always looking forward, if you're always looking at the task at hand, you can actually do things much more efficiently, quickly. He was probably wondering at some point if he was going to bump into somebody. She had no no problem at all. She knew she wasn't going to bump into him because she was looking the whole time. That's like sight reading. So if we can find a better way to never look down at our hands, we can eliminate this frustration over time. And it takes a while to master this concept, like that girl I was telling you about. She's taken a couple months to get good at this, but man, she has improved so much. With the simple act of finding the groups of 2 and 3 black keys, we can quickly find notes on the keyboard. So everybody just say this out loud with me. This is easy stuff, okay? But we're just gonna say C, D, E for every one on the keyboard, okay? Just say it out loud. Here we go. C, D, E, C, D, E, C, D, E. Those are the notes surrounding the 2 black keys. You guys all know that. Everybody who plays piano should know that, and just about everybody does. This is the most basic stuff. Okay, now let's say F, G, A, B. Okay, here we go. F, G, A, B. 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 Okay, who wants to help me demonstrate something? Okay, you in the back in the blue.
Okay, yes.
Okay. Okay, I close the piano lid. I want you to sit down at the piano. Okay, close your eyes. No looking. And I'm just going to only lift this up a little. I won't smash your hands. Okay, now put your hand onto the keyboard. Just your right hand. Okay, now can you find a C? Way to find a C on the keyboard. Feel around for a group of 3 black keys. Oh, nope, C's not moved by the 3 black keys. C's by the 2 black keys, and C is the one right beneath it. So all you do is you find your 2 black keys and you slide down to the C, okay? Close your eyes. We're gonna scoot you around on the bench so he's not marking his spot, okay? Now, find a C. So find the 2 black keys for me. You gotta find the ones that are real close to each other. Almost. Feel around, put your whole hand up here. Okay, yeah, get your left hand down, because that's just distracting. Okay, is this a group of 3 or 2? Okay, slide down to the one beneath the... You got it. Let's find a high F. Okay? High up on the keyboard. So scoot your hand up. There you go. Okay, now find a group of 3 black keys. Okay, found them. F's the one below it. You got it. Good. Okay, so you're the ones who hate, one of the ones who hate sight reading, right? Are you saying no as in I don't want to do this, or do you not hate sight reading?
No, I don't.
Okay, we're going to take a nice, easy one. Okay, don't get to look at your hands once. If you look at your hands once, you have to start all the way at the beginning. And I'm only going to make you do the first line. Okay? Now, I don't know how good you are, so this might take us a little while, okay? But I don't think it will. All right. So, what's that now? Can you name that now? A. Good. Okay, now, do not look down. Oh, you already looked at the keyboard. Okay. Okay, only look at music. We're just going to do right hand. Okay? Okay, find your 3 black keys. Now find an A. Play it for me. Okay, name the 4 notes that we said surround the black keys. Good. Okay, so you got your A. Okay, now just read this. Down. Start over. Don't look down. If you mess up, let's say that he totally screws up and he goes, and he's like, oh shoot. How in the world can he find it again? Okay, he's got to find the group of 3 black keys around here. Here's a B. He's got to find those 3 black keys and then find the B above it to reorient himself. No looking down ever. The only time I let students look down when they're sight reading is if it's a passage that's jumping back and forth with the left hand. Even then, it is beneficial to never look at the hands. It goes slower, but it is helpful. Okay, let's do it again. I'm only going to make you go to the end of the second measure. Oh, but find your 3 black keys. Okay, now F, G, A, B. Play those for me. Okay, now go to the A. Thank you. that note? Name it. Don't look at your hands. B. You're jumping all the way up to a D. So find the three black keys again. Okay? Now, find... Yes! You're already back. What's this note? You looked at your hands. No. E. Okay, so find the two black. You keep looking at your hands. You're going to have to start over. Okay, let's do it one more time. No looking. Self-conscious up here and like, oh, I feel so disoriented. But if you kept doing that for 2 months or a month or even a week, you would have more confidence because you never have to look down at your hands. That is a revolutionary concept. And I just tried it with one adult student because she's like, I'm terrible at sight reading. I need a lot of help. And I was so strict. I made her start over. She got to the very last measure one time and she looked down and was like, start over. She's like, oh, that just took us 10 minutes. I was like, we'll spend another 10 minutes of the lesson doing it because it's so important. And if your teacher stings you a little bit in the lesson and makes you feel like, ooh, I got to really do this, you'll usually do it in your practice. But if your teacher says, yeah, you can cheat, you probably won't do it. So, okay, I'll do this now. Okay, you guys get to put me on the spot. I brought a book of Mozart sonatas. Now, I've taught most of these at some point, but I haven't played a lot of Mozart sonatas. I've played a handful. Okay, so we have page 1 through 190. Somebody pick a random page. Yep.
54.
All right, and we're going to go to the nearest... We're going to go to the nearest beginning of a sonata so it's recognizable, so I'm not going to some random passage. And if I know that one, I'll go to the one before it, or actually with page 54, I'll go to the one after it. Okay. So, just because there's probably not a lot because these are long. Okay, so 54. Oh, it is one I've played, so let's go to the one after it. So that's the F major sonata in this book. Okay. Let's see here. Okay, sonata in B flat major. I've taught this before, never played it. The first step is to listen. So I'm gonna pull up, let's see. I'm gonna pull up my phone. It'll be soft, so you guys will have to really listen carefully. But I always like to listen first. The worst advice I ever received was from this ornery old woman at a competition, and I played, I was 17 years old, it was the National Chopin competition, and oh, she was so mean. Judges are usually supposed to give you critiques and then maybe some words of encouragement. She just gave me all horrible comments that really didn't make sense, and one of the pieces of advice was never listen to recordings because you need to develop your own voice. How in the world is a 17-year-old going to develop their own voice? It's the stupidest advice ever. You should listen to recordings all the time because...
Did you hear that, Suzuki students?
Yeah, listen to recordings. And it's not that you're listening to recordings so that you can play by ear. We're not doing that. We're going to apply the new sight reading techniques. I'm telling you guys have a really bad reputation as Suzuki students of not being able to read music. And it's not true, because I've seen a lot of you guys play really, really well at using good sight reading skills. So don't let that reputation. You guys develop ear training. People who aren't in the Suzuki method are often really terrible with ear training. They you'd say, is this the same note? And they say, I think that's an octave higher. And you're like, oh my gosh, no, it's a fifth. You know, so that's a... So there's advantages to different methods, and that's why we have so many different methods. There's advantages to each. Don't let yourself become poor sight readers. So listening is going to give us ideas on how to shape it. So my favorite Mozart pianist, one of my favorite Mozart pianists, is Mitsuko Uchida. So I'm going to say she's a Japanese pianist. So Mozart Sonata, this is K333. K. K stands for Kerschel. He's the guy who organized all of Mozart's music, and he put them in an order. So, let's see, this is the third movement, sorry. Let's see. Okay, so we're just going to pull it up a little, and I'm just going to do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 10 bars for you guys. That'll be fine. Okay. Here we go. You guys ready? Okay, so I kind of have an idea of the tempo. That's usually why I like to do the sight reading, listening before I sight read even. Gives me a little bit of idea of the piece. And you can sight read without listening. We're going to go over organized practice in a little bit, and that's even more important to listen with that. But let's just go through this, and if anybody catches me looking at my hands even once, you guys can just, call me out on it. All right, here we go. I'm going to take a tempo that is realistic for me, okay, to sight read. Now, there's a lot of pianists that have their doctorates that could just sight read this perfectly the first try. And I might be able to for the first 10 bars, but I know throughout the piece I'm not going to be able to keep that up perfectly. So I'm going to give a more realistic tempo, okay? This isn't the hardest piece. This isn't like a Rachmaninoff concerto or something. I remember a terrible experience was I went to this audition at Peabody Conservatory, and one of the scholarships was a scholarship for accompanists, and they put down this insanely hard piece after piece after piece. It was like 20 minutes of really hard sight reading at tempo, so you had to do it in full tempo. And they had violinists in there, they had vocalists singing along with you, which added to the pressure. And my job before going to Peabody was to be the doctoral quartet accompanist. So there was this vocal quartet of four people. So that's all I did, like, all the time, was accompany these people. And I did so poorly at the audition that the lady said, "Have you ever accompanied before?" And I was like, oh my gosh, how embarrassing. I'm so bad. So it was because it was full tempo and it was high pressure and it was like 11 p.m. And we had about 8 hours of testing that day, so that probably didn't help. But anyways, it was a crazy experience and it really showed me, okay, I've got to start only looking at my piece. So everybody feel more confident with their sight reading plan from here on out?
Yeah.
Don't look at your hands. And it's going to be frustrating. The first couple weeks, you're going to be like, he's crazy, this is way harder than looking down at my hands, and it will be true. But, I mean, I can do this. So here's Chopin Etude, or Chopin Ballade number 1. I'll play you the passage first, then I'll do it, eyes closed. Okay, now, as you do this sight reading stuff, you'll be able to find notes. It's something I've played for many years, so I should be able to do that, to be honest. It would be bad if I couldn't. But that shows you the value of sight reading. You no longer depend on looking down. You only have to look up at the answer sheet. It's so amazing to me how many kids look at me and they say, "Is that right?" Like, you tell me, the answer's right in front of your face. So, we're done with sight reading. Let's talk about organized practice. How do you guys learn a piece? Yeah?
Food.
What was that?
We, like, sometimes we use food to, like, encourage us.
Okay, so having rewards, using, like, my wife did that. She said every time I memorized another measure, I gave myself a piece of candy, like an M&M or something. So when I finished the bag of M&Ms, I knew I had most of the piece memorized. It was pretty good. Okay? What are some, just, like, if I gave you a piece of music and said, go home and learn this, how would you go about learning it? Yeah. Good. Very nice. Right hand slow, left hand slow, hands together slow. Anybody have any different methods that they use? Yeah?
It depends on the piece, but sometimes I start at the end.
Yes, good. What do you do there? Do you play every note backwards?
No. So I'll start, it's usually for longer pieces, but I'll, if the end's super hard, I'll start like the last page or the last two lines. I'll just learn those really well, hand separate first, and then I'll go and I'll work my way back to the beginning.
Why is that beneficial?
I don't know, but my teacher told me.
Okay, good. It's a very good method and something I'm going to cover here. Why do you think that would be really good? Yeah.
Because people remember the end better than the beginning, and so there's better than it has better impression on them.
Good. Yes, that's very true. The last, I think your first impression is actually the most important. So the beginning is arguably the most important. So I always have my students start an audition with their strongest piece, because it, if you start with your worst piece and work towards your best, the judges get a bad taste in their mouth and they say he's not very good. And then you keep getting better, and they're like, why did his first piece? Why was it so bad? Whereas if you start with your best, you don't necessarily work towards your worst at the end. But they have a good first impression. They say, this kid's amazing. And then if you have a couple little slips, their impression will go down a little, but it's still pretty high. But like he said, the ending is also very important. I think ending strong is equally, almost equally important. I think the beginning's the most, ending is very important. Because if you end the Chopin, that same piece, let's just take, you know, going to be like, oh, he really screwed that up, you know. So you want to end it strong, so that's good. What else? What, why is that psychologically so helpful to start at the end? Yeah.
If you start at the beginning, you know it really well and you practice it, and by the time you get to the end, you don't practice it as much. Is that more?
Yeah, that's really good for many reasons. I think you first of all get more tired throughout your practice session, so working backwards keeps you more focused and on track. I think psychologically, starting at the end always helps because you're always finishing. If I said, you know, we're going to train for a marathon, and you know, you and I are going to be training partners, we're going to run every single day, and we're going to start with 26 miles. You ready?
Yeah.
You'd be like, what the heck? What is he talking about? We're, I can't even, I don't know how much, you can probably run a lot further than I can, but I'd be like, oh boy, I need to start with a mile first, you know, and then work up to two. Starting backwards is like working up. You could say you could do that same thing from the beginning, but if you always have an ending point, you're always finishing, you're like, yeah, I did it, I finished the piece. Okay, let me take a little bit more. Okay, yeah, I finished the piece, a little bit more. Versus, I'm working into this, you know, dark abyss, I never know when the piece is going to end. Oh, finally it ends. It's a point of relief at the end, and you never really get the reward along the way of always finishing something. So that's very important. So, I'm getting a little off track here, but you guys totally already kind of inserted some of my ideas here. One of the best ways to do that, she was talking about doing two lines at a time. I like to do anywhere between like 6 to 16 bars, according to how hard the piece is. I set up a rescue point. So what I do is I'll practice from that rescue point to the end. You know, just kind of, and I will memorize that chord so perfectly, that rescue point, so that when I'm going through the piece, if I screw up in this section, I will jump ahead to that next rescue point. You never want to go back, because sometimes you might keep screwing up at that same point. I've watched somebody do that with an orchestra before. It was heartbreaking. She had to start over, then they did it again. Then she messed up at the same place, started over. So you always want to jump ahead to the next rescue point. So you set up these rescue points, then Once you've set up the rescue points, you do two bars at a time. Two bars, right hand, left hand, hands together. It's so efficient. I need I need two volunteers. Okay? Anybody else? Okay, you've already demonstrated. Do you want to come up? All right, since you volunteered first, do you want the easy or the hard example?
Easy.
Easy? Okay. So we're going to test these, the memory of these two, okay? And this will come back into how to organize your practicing. I need you to remember seven words for me, okay? Here's the words. They are, let's see, got to find it here. Okay. Ball, lamp, television, store, computer, car, money. Say those back with me. Ball, lamp, television, store, computer, car, money. But I'm going to give you a story to help you remember it, okay? So, here's the story. My brother and I accidentally kicked a ball in the house, which hit the lamp, which fell into the TV, which ended up cracking the TV screen, okay? We hopped on our computer to search for the nearest store to fix it, and then we got in the car to go to the store, and when we got there, we handed the repairman some money in order to fix it. Okay, so can you name back those seven items?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Ball, lamp, TV, computer, store, money.
And how'd we get to the store?
Car.
You got them. Very nice. Okay. I want you. Okay, so they've done scientific studies and they say we can remember about seven pieces of information at once. Okay? So, if you guys ever wonder why phone numbers are seven numbers, we can remember them. You know, if they go to eight or nine, people just fall apart. They can't remember them. So, I want. Are you ready for the hard example? Okay. I mean, you got to say these back in order to me, okay? I want you to name these 20 numbers back to me, okay? 9, 87, 46, 3, 51, 67, 98, 36, 21, 34, 56, 72, 13, 65, 88, 43, 1, 34, 77, 22. Okay? Can you remember the first number?
No.
She can't remember one out of 20, but he got 7 for 7? Well, there's a couple of reasons for that. Okay, first of all, the numbers are just random. I told him a story to remember. So that's like music. You can create a story to go along with each passage, or you can analyze the theory behind it. So you can say, hey, this is an F major chord going to a C major chord. Or you can create images, like I was kind of saying before with the storyline. Those random numbers are like trying to memorize this Mozart sonata by going G, F, E flat, D, C, B flat, D, G. I could never. It would take me 100 years to try to memorize that just with a random sequence with no meaning behind it. But a couple of strategies that you could use is analyzing the music, sing the melody away from the piano. I'm a terrible singer, so here you go. I already know it. You know, and I'm familiar with this piece, so I know it even more. But you could do that even with a new piece. You can study the music away from the piano. You can take this book, go sit at the kitchen table. This does not sound like as fun as a video game, but you know, you go like this and you just read it and you try to sing it in your head. You try to imagine what the piano sounds like. This takes practice. And some people can naturally do it and some people naturally have a harder time with it, but you can develop it, okay? And you can actually memorize it. And you can memorize it according to chords. Sorry to make you guys stand up here. Thank you for your help. Let's give him a hand. Also, I have a confession to make. She did about 39 pieces of information, actually 38. There's about 38 numbers in there. I could be wrong. I think there was only a couple of single numbers and then two double digit. So 2 times 20 numbers is 40 pieces of info. But and then there was a couple single numbers. So about 37 pieces of information I gave her. I actually gave him 39 pieces of information because if you spell out C-A-R-S-T-O-R-E. And you go through, he actually knew more pieces of information than she did. She did 38 pieces of info, he did 39. Why was he so successful?
The story.
The connection with the words, and then we made the story. And when you're thinking of a word, if you say, oh, look at that piano, I don't say P-I-A-N-O, piano. Oh yeah, that's that black thing that I press those keys down. Yeah, oh, I know what you're talking about, piano. You immediately recognize that. So when you're playing a piece, this is a B flat major chord. This is a five finger pattern that steps down to a B flat. That's two pieces of information. I already have it memorized. So let's see. Okay, you got that memorized. This goes to a G minor chord. Memorizing the up down, that's one piece of information, and then I know it's G minor. So I have three pieces of info now that cover 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 pieces of info is boiled down to three pieces. Here we go. Got my five finger pattern coming down. B flat major, G minor, with the step up. See how easy that is? Now you gotta get good at your theory. You've gotta work your chords. Take you 6 months to get really good at, but it will pay a lifetime of dividends. You will get really good at these pieces. Okay, you'll get so good at learning pieces quicker. You'll get better at memorizing. Okay, we've already kind of gone through this. I was going to demonstrate learning this, but we're running out of time. So let's just go over polishing a piece, okay? I want to show you some of my favorite tricks. Okay, so anytime... So I'm going to demonstrate with this famous piece called La Campanella. Maybe you guys know it. How many of you know that piece? How many of you heard it?
Heard it.
Okay. A lot of you guys. Okay. I'm going to show you different trouble spots in that piece for me and what I do to fix them. Okay. This is just a crash course of some of my favorite things. I've got four things here. Okay, anytime you have scalar passages, like a chromatic scale. Okay, and let's say that just totally stinks. You just can't play it. The best way to fix it that I found for me, there's lots of ways to fix it, and I sometimes use more than one way, but my favorite way is rhythms. And then just doing the opposite. Long, short, long, short, long, or short, long, short, long, short, long, and after, over time. It will get easier. Let's talk about jumps. How many of you have ever missed a note jumping to it? Raise your hands. Okay, we all have. Yeah, I miss them all the time. How about this passage? That's pretty tough. Okay, so the jumps. What I do is I do this really psychotic exercise. It's called the up-down exercise. You go like this. You go up-down, up-down, up-down. Let's see. I should have my music in front of me. So what I'm doing is I'm flipping my wrist back down because I want to get back down onto the keys. What most people do is they play up, and then they say, oh, shoot, where am I going? And then they start chopping at the keys. They go... If I practice getting back down really fast, it looks very strange, you know? But then when you do it, being very quiet, and you seem engaged. I'm practicing right now. I'm doing repetitions. I'm playing the same thing over and over again. These are all the things you guys said you hated, right? It's pretty interesting. When you have a plan, Okay. When you have a method to help you. How about this first section? Screwing that up. How about eyes closed? Feeling around for those keys. Kind of like I made that kid do when he was doing sight reading. Make it like 10 times harder for yourself. Close your eyes, then when you open them, you're like, oh my gosh, this is so easy. Even though your audience is thinking, holy smokes, they're amazing. How do they ever do that? Great little tip. Finally, one of my favorite things is this exercise called add-on. I remember I was in a lesson. There was this horrible passage. It was the Barber Sonata, which is crazy enough. Okay? But there was this little passage that kept shifting the beat. It went... It's like a labyrinth. And it was a really cool effect, you know, in the piece when you're going... I could not memorize that stupid thing. I spent 2 weeks going through every method that I could remember. And I got to my lesson, my teacher said, did you do add-on? And I said, oh, I forgot to do that. I went home, did it for 20 minutes, had it perfect. The method is, let's say that here's this really crazy passage in La Cabanella. Let's say that's just not working out and goes fast. Okay, let's say that you're just going and just messing up. You start with the last part. Okay, and then you go back. There. I better pull up this music, I'm sorry. I can't remember all this off the top of my head. Working backwards in your mind is so hard. Okay. Okay, here we go. So, I'm going to take this last little part. Maybe that's even too much. I'll just take this. And then work backwards. Like that girl was telling us, you know, we have... Our brain always works really well doing backwards. How about one more? One more? One more. Let's say that one's bad. I'll add each one. Then I could add one note before it, and then one note after it. Then maybe a little bit more. So you don't like have to always add on backwards. Let's add on forwards now. Okay, let's add the next one. That guy. Okay, let's add the next one. Now. Okay, next one. Next. Now. All the way through. Add the left hand. Okay, it works. I promise it works. I'm taking you through these examples really quickly, and this is stuff I've already practiced. Okay, so don't expect to go home and do that in an instant, because that took me several hours. You know, over the course of many years, you know, just working each individual note. It will help though. So, our three main things to recap from today are sight reading, organized practice, and you guys actually knew a lot more about organized practice than I thought. And finally, polishing a piece, some of those tricks. If you want to look on my YouTube channel, I have over like 250 videos on different little elements of technique. A lot of them are, I talked about today, some of those favorite methods. There's a little playlist on my YouTube channel that says videos Josh considers most valuable. So you can kind of start there and then work out from there. So thank you so much. Do you guys have any questions for me? It can be about anything related to piano. Yeah.
How long have you been playing?
I've played for 24 years. So I'm 29 and I started when I was 5.
What's your favorite type of music to play?
My favorite is classical, and Chopin is my favorite composer. I think I might actually just be, I haven't completely decided yet, but I think I might try to specialize in Chopin's music. I just really like his stuff so much. Maybe try and record all of his works over the next 10 or 15 years or something. Okay. Yeah?
Sorry, do you ever hear a song on the radio and just not looking at the music, you can just play it from memory?
Once you know your theory, you can actually do that somewhat well. You'll notice a lot of patterns, especially in like pop and rock music. It's usually just boiled down to like 1-4-5-1 progressions. And so you, if you can pluck out the melody, you can usually find the chords underneath it. But if you have no idea about chords, that'll be really hard. So that's why I recommend learning your triads, the three note chords, and then your four note chords, which are seventh chords. And the reason they call them seventh chords is because it's a seventh above the bass. Once you know those, I mean, you've covered all the pop harmonies that you're gonna hear for the most part.
Do you have any tips on showing and teaching technique to younger students?
Yes, I think, so to learn technique, if they're really young, I'll use little books like A Dozen a Day, just little exercises, or, you know, Czerny, you know, the easy Czerny exercises, or Schmidt preparatory exercises where you have them hold down one note and then they do staccato and the rest. That's very helpful. The things I focus on with technique is I'll have them put their hand flat on the keyboard, then pull their fingertips in and scratch the keys. I'll be like, you know, scratch them like a cat. And then when you play down, make sure your joints don't collapse. A fun little game you can do with little kids is, actually, I'll have you do it. You look pretty strong. Okay, come up here. I'll even give you my left hand, which is my weaker hand. Try to push in that joint. Okay, he had to, how much pressure did you have to do?
Decent amount, yeah.
Decent?
Yeah.
Okay, I don't know if decent is the right word. Okay, he's got nice strong fingers too. I tried to do my right hand now. Okay, do the pinky. Okay, he can get the pinky. How about the fourth finger? He got the fourth finger pretty easily. Fourth finger is always the weakest finger, okay? I think your pinky's usually stronger than your fourth because you use it so much. That's a fun game to play with little kids. They'll always remember to have their fingers curved because you say, oh, let me check, and then they'll curve their hands and they'll, you know, do that. Whereas most people, their natural inclination is to collapse that joint. Good question. Other questions? Oh, yeah.
What's the hardest piece you've ever played?
There's been quite a few. That La Campanella has definitely given me challenges over the years. My least favorite is something I'm working on right now. Least favorite difficult piece is this Chopin Etude. It's incredibly difficult. You play the entire piece with 3, 4, and 5. So. It is so hard. And I've been working on that a lot lately because I need to do a tutorial of all the Chopin Etudes. And that one's the one I've been dreading doing. So I'm working on that. So every single day what I do is I'll just apply a lot of these same concepts I've taught you guys. I'll just practice slowly with no tension. And then maybe I'll try a couple of the chords beneath it. Maybe I'll do some rhythm. And then I'll try playing it light. Okay, but it's a work in progress. So. That Chopin Etude, Rachmaninoff concertos are also very hard. I've played 3 of those. Anything else?
Yeah. How many hours a day did you practice when you were like younger?
Good. Yeah. So when I was about 9, I switched to my university teacher and she said, I want you doing 2.5 hours a day. So I did about 2.5 hours a day from 9 until 16, which compared to a lot of my peers was quite little, you know, like peers that were playing piano at the international competition level. A lot of them do 4 to 6 to 8 hours a day. So 2.5 was really kind of scraping by to be able to compete at that level. And then once I was 16 or 17, I tried to do more like 3 or 4 hours a day. And now that I teach so much and do a lot of different projects. I do a lot of YouTube videos teaching and do a lot of online business stuff. I try to get at least 2 hours in a day. Sometimes that happens, sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes I'll do more, sometimes I'll do less. But I really attribute my success to that daily practice, and I like never missed. I mean, I probably missed 10 times. Besides holidays, I probably missed like 10 days in 10 years. You know, I mean, it just never missed. Anything else? Yeah.
Sorry, I'm asking you so many questions.
It's okay.
Do you have like anything that you wish you would have known at our age about playing the piano, like to stay with it and stuff like that?
If you know you want to be a pianist, stop playing video games, stop doing trivial things, because one thing I always wish is I wish I knew more pieces. I wish I had a bigger repertoire. I wish I had spent even more time at the piano. And it's important to have a well-rounded life. I'm not saying, you know, you do 8 hours a day, but if you know you want to do piano and you're putting in an hour a day, that's pretty weak. If you are doing piano as a hobby or something you enjoy or just as an extracurricular activity, an hour is great. But if you're like, I think I want to pursue music, practice more. Some of the things that I wish I knew, you can find on my YouTube channel. If I had known all of these things, I would have gotten a lot better, a lot quicker. It's taken me several years to compile this, and I'm doing this to try to help people who either can't afford lessons with really high quality teachers or who just want some extra supplemental practice methods that will help speed up the process. So everything on my YouTube channel and practice more. Yeah.
Can you play us your favorite song?
I will next Thursday. My favorite pieces are the Chopin ballades. And they're about 10 minutes long, so I don't want to, you've already sat through a long presentation here. But I'll be playing those, and I've also posted them on YouTube. I did it for my last doctoral recital. And the ballade number 4, which I'll play, was really fresh on that recital, so it should be better next Thursday than on what I have on YouTube. Okay. All right. Thank you guys so much.